at 1600 Pennsylvania Avenue and beyond. This week, the president honored Father's Day and the WNBA champion Indiana Fever at the White House before embarking on a four-day trip to the G8 summit in Northern Ireland and then on to Berlin. That's June 14th to June 20th, or what's the crack? On Friday, the president hosted a Father's Day luncheon for fathers and children as part of his Fatherhood and Mentoring Initiative, where he was joined by 15 Becoming a Man program participants, with whom he met in Chicago last February. And how about that baby?
Very relaxed.
Later, the president welcomed the WNBA champion Indiana Fever to the White House to honor the team's victory and their dedication to community service. And on Sunday, at Father's Day, it was time for the first family to fly east for an overnight trip over the Atlantic Ocean to get started on the trip to the UK and Germany. The president and the first family touched down in Belfast, where they highlighted the hard work, dialogue, fellow world leaders gathered to address pressing economic, political, and security challenges from around the globe, and to promote the advancement of trade and greater transparency among G8 members and the developing world. As a result of their work there, the president announced the launch of negotiations on a new trade agreement, the Transatlantic Trade and Investment Partnership, also known as TTIP.
We invest nearly $4 trillion in each other's economies, and all that supports around 13 million jobs on both sides of the Atlantic. And this potentially groundbreaking partnership would deepen those ties.
Then, on a balmy Tuesday evening, it was time to leave the Emerald Isle, and the first family traveled on to Berlin for an official visit and to reaffirm the strong ties between the U.S. and Germany, our vital ally and economic partner. On Wednesday, the President and First Lady stopped by to give special thanks to a gathering of embassy staff and spent some time visiting with their families. Then it was time to meet the President for this President's official welcome ceremony at the historic Schloss Bellevue.
Good to see you, man.
He then traveled to the Chancellery, where he and Chancellor Merkel continued discussions on a wide range of bilateral and global issues.
In both conversations with Chancellor Merkel and earlier with your president, I reminded them that the relationship with Europe remains the cornerstone of our freedom and our security.
Later that afternoon, at the invitation of Chancellor Merkel, the president returned to the public podium 5 years after speaking there as a senator and 50 years after President Kennedy's famous Ich bin ein Berliner speech. Standing on the east side of the Brandenburg Gate, in front of a crowd of 4,500 Germans on the first hot day of summer, the president addressed the deep and enduring bonds between the U.S. and Germany, the vital importance of the transatlantic alliance, and the important values that bind our nations together.
Complacency is not the character of great nations. And I've come here to this city of hope because the tests of our time demand the same fighting spirit that defined Berlin.
Then, on a lovely summer night in this European capital, it was time to return to our capital and wrap up this West Wing week. Stay tuned, though, .gov. And thanks again for checking out your web.
All the way to Germany and do a show called Mega World and not mention the most popular car company in all of Europe. Of course, I'm talking about Volkswagen, makers of this beauty, the original Volkswagen Bug. Oh, what a timeless classic. You know, the company continues to make waves in the automotive industry by taking our idea of what a car factory should be and turning it upside down. Or maybe I should say, inside out. Paul and Brigitte Vitalios could be entering Germany's newest art gallery. Or maybe it's a concert hall. Or a really upscale hotel. Well, think again. They're here to buy a car. They've come to one of the most innovative manufacturing facilities in the world. It's in the heart of downtown Dresden, a city best known for its historic buildings. But that's changing thanks to Volkswagen's new transparent factory.
As the name Transparent Factory says, it's transparent. You can see everything here in the Transparent Factory.
Part assembly plant, part museum, it's the only factory in the world where you can peer through glass walls and see cars being made right before your eyes. Instead of concrete, the floors are Canadian maple. Instead of dark overalls, all the workers wear white, right down to their fingertips. And everywhere you look, there's glass, glass, and more glass. It's all meant to symbolize the high-quality, high-end vehicle they produce here, a luxury car called the Phaeton. But selling the people of Dresden on the idea of a downtown factory required some creative thinking.
So they expected like big traffic, pollution and noise. And what we now have is a very quiet place and with almost no traffic, because all of our parts we're getting with a cargo tram.
The VW cargo trams share streetcar tracks with the city's public transit vehicles. They deliver auto parts directly to the factory. Inside, the parts are sorted into containers. A robotic sled then drives each container through the assembly hall, up and down elevators, finally parking beside one specific car body. The robots find their way with the help of a special magnetic guidance system.
So this driverless transportation system is orientating by over 60,000 magnets embedded in the floor like a road map.
With the correct parts at hand, the assembly team set to work. And while they work, they're gently put into motion. The entire production line sits on a wide conveyor belt built into the floor. It moves ever so slowly in a big loop around the factory. The floor also delivers power for tools and computer systems.
This portable workstation is getting the energy by induction from the floor, and it runs this computer system. So this computer tracks every screw for safety relevant systems like the airbag system.
These intelligent tools actually register when a specific bolt or screw is fitted. That way, the computer knows when each car is ready for the next assembly stage.
One screw is missing, and then this car's ready.
After one complete lap on the floor conveyor, the cars begin a second tour of the factory, this time suspended from on high.
And the suspended conveyor is a system which was developed with the University of Dresden to move the cars and, of course, to get the cars in different positions so we can change the angles and the height of the cars for each worker to have the best position for him to do his working steps individually on his car.
With the electric car lifter, I can adjust it so I can work at any angle. For example, I can work underneath the floor panel here to do things like plug in these air hoses.
The chassis seem to float overhead, as if performing some sort of bizarre automotive ballet. To enjoy the show, tourists are invited right into the assembly area.
When I came here, joined this, working here in the transplant factory, whatever I did was visible for everybody. But you get used to this. It's kind of two, 3 weeks, and it's kind of normal.
Customers get the best view of all right on the production line. Paul and Brigitte are here to see the most crucial stage. A robotic sled moves the drivetrain into position. It then gets bolted to the chassis. It's sort of like some James Bond version of the future come to life. Some customers go even further and actually help build their new ride.
One time I had some women from Saudi Arabia, and they were really like doing all the screws, and they didn't want to stop.
At the end of the line, the newly minted Phaetons go through a series of quality control checks.
Here we are now in the final check. This is a light tunnel. Here we are checking the lacquer, and we are checking for scratches and for small imperfections. And you see here we have different lights. We want to simulate with this light, every light, what you find also in nature.
After a final buff and polish, it's off to the storage silo, yet another unique feature of the transparent factory. Each new car will wait here for its new owner. Unless, of course, the new owner is already waiting for his or her new Phaeton. In that case, there's only one thing left to do.
Okay, I know what you're thinking. They didn't let me drive the Phaeton. No worries. This Volkswagen Bug, this is just fine by me. And for Mega World Germany, well, hey, guess what? We're done. It's a wrap. I hope you've enjoyed some of the stories we've brought you from Germany, some of the awesome projects going on here that help make this country such an engineering powerhouse. As for me, well, I'm out of here. From Berlin's Brandenburg Gate, I'm Kevin Brosch. Tschüss. See you next time.